25 of Worship Christ the Risen King. Sing number 225.
Thank you. Father, again, we come to you grateful that we can call you Father. We are also thankful that we can participate in the advancement of your kingdom through our tithes and offerings. We pray that we give cheerfully today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise Him, all creatures, hear me, Lord.
to say a couple of words about that. We, if you're here, not a member of this church, and you want to take communion with us, you can do that. And you need to know that kids sort of wailing during the service is perfectly okay. Amen? It's okay. It is perfectly fine. Wail on. But as far as communion goes, we'd love for you to participate. And we understand that what we are doing in coming for communion, you getting out from your pew and walking down to participate in communion is an indication that you know that your life isn't what it needs to be. By the way, I'll take communion as well. I'll take communion as well. And what it says to the Lord is, I can't do this. I cannot be the believer that I need to be without the blood and the body of Christ, the one who rose on the third day. Amen?
Amen.
And so, if you want to participate, I want you to feel the freedom to do that. If you can't physically walk up to the altar, then we'll bring it to you. Okay? So pray with me, if you will. Father, thank you for this day again. We pray that as we partake of the elements, Lord, that we would recognize just how wonderful this event was that night as the Lord Jesus shared that supper with those disciples. He knew what was getting ready to happen and celebrated with him that time. Let us do likewise as we do that today. So, men, if you'll remove the cloth. We know that night that the Lord Jesus told the disciples what was getting ready to happen, and he made a comment to them that the bread was his body, and that his body would be broken for us. So we know that that's the case. And as he did that, he told them to take it and to eat it. Likewise, with the wine, he told them that this was his blood, that he would shed his blood on behalf of his people. And we know that he did that on that Friday. So if you would like to participate in communion, you can come. We'll have it on both sides. And if you'll go ahead and go down.
Thank you.
verses of He Lives. That's sin number 220.
From the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power, in being guarded with faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of our faith, more precious than gold that perishes through and is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy in the inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was there to be yours, search and inquire carefully, inquiring that person or time or spirit of Jesus in them was indicated when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves but you. In the things that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Y'all, it's just one more.
I know you look at that lengthy scripture passage and you think, we're going to be here until 10 o'clock. We're not, I promise. I encountered a couple of very good quotes this week in reading. One was by a theologian named Joe Beakey. He said, the greatest news that ever came from a graveyard. I like that. And another theologian once remarked in a class, all sound theology must begin and end with doxology. R.C. Sproul heard one of his professors make that comment, and he never forgot that. And I'd say the same thing, that we ought to begin with doxology as we are in our homes, as we're reading the Word of God, as we are in churches and Bible studies, whatever it may be. I fear we have become far too familiar with the virgin birth, with the crucifixion, and with the resurrection. I fear that Christians have heard that so much that it's just not a big deal anymore. How about you? I mean, it's just another resurrection, it's another Easter Sunday, another sunrise service. I'll get up and go, because that's what we do. But we've got to make sure that we understand that when we talk about the resurrection of Christ, we're talking about everything that we believe. Rises or falls on the resurrection of Christ. Everything. Everything. So when we fail to sing the doxology as we think, preach, converse about those things, we're in grave error when we do that. I was thinking about Easter this week, as everybody probably was, for different reasons, and curious how the United States was viewing the whole idea of Easter and resurrection. As I had put the sort of, I never put final touches on sermon. I'm editing all the way up until the second I stand here. But yesterday, a news story across that I read that said the president of our United States had declared today Transgender Visibility Day. Now that's a slap, obviously, in the face of Christians. There's no doubt what's happening here. But folks, I refuse to get irate about that. I can tell you why, because I don't believe that the majority of the politicians in Washington are believers. I just don't. Look, they killed Jesus. They killed the apostles.
We get irritated because the president signs a proclamation. I don't like it, don't get me wrong. I wish he hadn't done that. He also didn't allow any religious symbols for Easter eggs at the Easter egg hunt at the White House. And so it doesn't surprise me that our culture has taken something that we value and think is important and twisted it into something else. It doesn't surprise me at all. Most of the miraculous events of Scripture have been ridiculed by culture, led by the academic class and scientists for decades, because we were told that science was the only thing that really mattered until recently. These same academics and scientists have so proven themselves untrustworthy with their perspectives on COVID, ivermectin, gender fluidity, that now we don't trust anybody, right? We just don't. So let's look, I didn't mean to divert there, but that article just sort of twisted my mind a little bit yesterday. But every generation is questioning the miracles of Christ. There is no miracles in the Word of God. You see, if we could merely hit the delete button on creation, on Moses parting the Red Sea, if we could just hit the delete button on the healings in the New Testament and the Old Testament, if we could just hit the delete button on the virgin birth, the resurrection, the deity of Christ, we'd be left with a pretty believable story, would we not? We really would. Wouldn't we be left with a believable story of people trying to be good and a good man who sacrificed his life for what he believed? Right? Now, people are already there for the most part. It's understandable why our culture has replaced the miracle of resurrection with Easter being a time of renewal and bunnies and eggs and candy and new clothes and such. The culture has replaced timeless truths in the Word of God with cheap, shiny replacements, so that we've got people that don't even know that Jesus Christ even lived. Because look, if you take out the resurrection, if you take out the virgin birth, what difference does it make? Folks, it doesn't make any difference. You know who I fault for this? I put the fault squarely at the feet of the government. No, not really. It's not the government. The evangelical church has gotten much to bear the blame here. It's noticeable that here recently, church attendance in the United States dipped below 50% for the first time ever in the United States of America. The number of people who never attend, seldom attend, or maybe attend is almost 70% at this point in our country. And it's no surprise that while that is occurring, belief in the deity of Christ and the resurrection is dwindling as well. 5 years ago, there was a survey done in the UK that said that in the evangelical, this shocked me, 47% of evangelicals in the UK believe in the resurrection. Did you hear what I said? 47% of people who said they were Christians said they believed in the resurrection. And you do know that what's across the pond is going to jump the pond. And it is going to be here. We'll be there. And with these things occurring, with declining church attendance, weak pulpits, denominations that reject a liberal approach to Scripture, the future is bleak for many churches, and definitely the culture as well. And it might depress us to do that. I refuse to be depressed. I refuse. Believe believers, genuine followers of Christ, have always been a minority, folks. Why should we be any different? Amen? I didn't hear an amen, folks. Look, if you think the United States is a Christian nation, you are badly mistaken. It is not. It is not. Nor am I concerned about politics in Washington and Jackson or Nashville. I'm not. I don't think a politician is going to bring back revival in the churches, regardless of their party, by the way. You understand? What we're here for is to celebrate the resurrection of Christ. And to do that, we've got to recognize we are in the minority in this country. We are in the minority around the world. And we can either bemoan the fact that an article about the President of the United States talking about those things is going to depress us, or just recognize that's the culture that we live in. And as believers, what are we supposed to do with people who are struggling with their gender identity? We love them. We don't hate them. We don't wish they didn't exist. If we encounter someone with whom we disagree about that, we don't shun them and hate them and push them out. We love them. We love them. Every generation has attacked Jesus Christ. Every generation has attacked the person of God. And we can expect that to continue. If that's true, folks, then what are we supposed to do? We are supposed to live in hope, and that hope is rooted in why we're here today. I recognize this is a little different than my normal verse-by-verse approach to a text. But you understand, if the resurrection didn't happen, if we just take that perspective, there's really no hope. There's really no reason for us to gather today, or for any day for that matter, because life either has meaning or it does not. And it only has meaning if something follows this life. Amen? That those are the only options. If there is nothing at the end of this life, then the ultimate reality is across the street. Now, that should depress us if that were true. And these are the thoughts that really Paul gave in 1 Corinthians 15. In that chapter, Paul is pleading with the church there at Corinth to have hope because of the resurrection. He was defending the Word of God. He was defending the gospel of Christ. Folks, can I tell you why I think it is that our country is doubting the resurrection, and doubting the crucifixion, and doubting creation, and doubting the Word of God? I've met the enemy, and the enemy is us. We're living like it's Thursday and not Sunday. We're living like it's Thursday and not Sunday. R.C. Sproul commented that death remains a frightening unknown, the monster under the bed. However, this is what I've noticed, and maybe you have too, that children who are fearful gain comfort in knowing that mom and dad are right there, don't they? That some of them can even be in the next room, but understanding that mom and dad are in the next room, fear is gone. The fact of a parent's presence is stronger than a child's fears. And we as believers may have fears regarding the process of dying, but unbelievers realize that death is their enemy. As believers, we genuinely believe
that when we die, it is merely a passage from where we are to Jesus. Amen? Otherwise, why are we here?
If you don't believe that, there's no reason for you to get up, well, especially, and come to a sunrise service, but even at an 11 o'clock service, there's no reason for you to come if you don't believe that. And we actually own a book that has eyewitness accounts of Jesus being raised from the dead. We have eyewitness accounts of him being led away. We have eyewitness accounts of him being crucified, of him dying, him being put in the tomb, and him appearing to those disciples. You see, there was a Friday, but then came Sunday. I don't have time to list all the things that I read this last week. There were just so many, but one volume that I read was a theology book by John MacArthur and Richard Mayhew. They talked about the 20 results of the resurrection. And here's just a couple. By being resurrected, Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament scriptures. He fulfilled his own predictions. It confirmed his deity. It established Sunday as the day for corporate worship. It established the basis for an unshakable hope. It guaranteed the future resurrection life for believers. It declared Christ as the head of the church. And there's about 15 more of them as well. And I can tell you this. A genuine belief in the resurrection all changes. And we actually have somebody in the New Testament who was changed. And his name is Peter. I want you to think about Peter with me just for a minute. You remember the last time he saw Jesus, he saw him through basically a door in one of the trials. And then what does he do? He denies Jesus. If there was ever anybody who should have been despondent, who should have been depressed, and had a sense of failure, it should have been the one who denied Jesus. And at one point, we know the word had come that Jesus had died. It was Friday when he died. But folks, then came Sunday. Then came Sunday. They heard his body been removed from the cross, prepped for burial. That's what happened to people who had died. They prepared bodies for burial. This tomb, this body was put in the tomb, and there was a seal put on that tomb as well. The Romans put a guard there. It was Friday. Then came Sunday. Are you living in Thursday? Are you living on Sunday? I'm serious. If you're living your faith on Thursday, it means one thing. If you're living it on a Sunday, it's another. After the ladies reported what they had experienced, Peter and John raced to the tomb. John, having whatever sense about him, was running and running, and he stops, and the Greek word there is so, it's fun for me, but the Greek is so interesting right there. He leans over and he peers over and he looks in that tomb, and I'm sure he's just thinking, it's true. Of course, Peter, being Peter, he probably just knocks John out of the way. I mean, Scripture doesn't say that, but I could see him just barreling on into the tomb, and Peter sees the grave clothes and the neatly folded head covering. Can you imagine their responses? We know that eventually Peter sees Jesus again, and Jesus restores him again. Peter was despondent over that Friday, but then came Sunday. And then when the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost, it empowered Peter. But the resurrection impacted Peter as well.
That resurrection was an absolute reminder of what Jesus said he would do. You know, the first person to make a public proclamation about the resurrection was the one who denied Jesus. Peter stood and preached to the multitudes of Jewish people who were there. And in that sermon, Peter stated a fact. He made an assertion, and he gave a reason for that assertion as well. And we know that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection was no accident. Can I tell you this? That before the foundation of the world, the scripture says the Lamb was slain. God had already worked out salvation before he created the world. The Trinity had decided that Jesus would sacrifice his life. It was predestined that that would happen. And that was not some mere example for you or for me. Folks, it just wasn't. The Trinity was involved in the raising of Jesus from the dead. You could look at Romans 6:4, Romans 8:11, John 2:19. Then we had Peter writing an epistle, and I'm just going to touch on a couple of things in 1 Peter, and then we'll stop. In that first chapter of 1 Peter, it's a great passage of scripture. If you've got your Bibles, or you've got your bulletins, Jeff always does so well in printing that text right there for us. But if you look at verse 12 just for a second, I've always enjoyed seeing this in verse 12. It's a long verse, but at the end of that verse, it says, things into which angels long to look. You know, I get this idea that when we have our Bibles open, it's like the angels are wanting to peer over our shoulders because they do not have the Word of God. That's something that we have that they don't have. I love that. It's got nothing to do with the sermon, but I just love that. I just love that. So look at our hope. And then we'll look at our inheritance. And then we'll stop. You know, our hope as the people of God is an understanding that we are His people. And just as the resurrection was a Trinitarian fact, so is our salvation as well. And you can see that there in our verses. If you just start at verse 3 now, if we'll look at verse 3. He says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Peter begins with doxology. And then he says, according to his great mercy. You see, I don't understand before time began, God saw this, but he knew that we would be incapable of helping ourselves. And he had mercy on us. There's a difference between mercy and compassion. Mercy is me seeing somebody in need and want. And doing something. That's right. Doing something. That's the word here. God in His great mercy. See, He could have done this, folks. He could have created the world, created human beings, and then backed up and just let the thing happen and said, look, I hope you make it. That is Henry style, isn't it? But that is not what God did. Mercy is this word that tells us God knew our plight as sinners and He did something about it. He didn't just see us and hope for the best. This hope is a confident assurance, and it is living as well. And I want you to look in that verse.
Verse 3, he says, according to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope. How? Through the resurrection. You understand that everything that we believe about our salvation is based on the fact of the resurrection. Everything. If Jesus isn't raised, you might as well just go home. Based on the resurrection of Christ. Jesus was the first one to break the bonds of death. And because of that, you and I can have new birth and eternal life. Peter speaks here as an eyewitness. See, Peter wasn't stuck on Friday. He was living every day as a Sunday. Every day as a Sunday. The Jews of that day believed that if they were good enough to keep the law, they would have God's favor. And if that's true, then if Jesus didn't have to die, he didn't have to. And then he didn't have to raise on the third day. Can I just tell you, you've heard me say this 500 times. Most of the religions of the world, most of them, except one, believe you've got to be good enough and you've got to stay good enough to be a follower of Christ. That's a religion of human achievement. And if you believe that, that never ends. And at some point, if you're not achieving anymore, it's done. Christianity is the only religion in the world that believes in divine accomplishment. That what Jesus Christ did on the cross when he died and rose is sufficient to save us. So the last thing that I want to talk about for a second is our inheritance in verse 4. I love this. Our inheritance is also gained only by the cross and the resurrection. And it's one this text says can never perish. Normally, when we talk about an inheritance, it refers to the death of somebody. Here, Peter's using the word inheritance in the context of life. Our inheritance through the resurrection of Christ awaits us in heaven. I don't believe that across the street is the end. Do you? Well, then quit living like it's Thursday. Begin to live like you truly believe that Jesus Christ died and rose on the third day from the dead, and he is making a difference in my life. Amen? We've got to quit playing around. We've got to stop that. We've got to quit being fearful that people might hear us say the word Jesus and make fun of us. They will. But if you can't take somebody mocking you for your Christianity here, that's a problem. But our inheritance tells us, Peter tells us that our inheritance is imperishable, it's undefiled, it's unfading, and it is kept by the power of God. Our inheritance, the one Jesus has secured for us with his death and resurrection, is not subject to death or destruction. It is also unstained. It is unpolluted. It is flawless. It is perfect. It is unfading. You know, men, when you mess up and you go to Kroger or some other place and pick up some flowers praying that your wife will forgive you, y'all never do that, do you? Wow. I guess I'm the only one. But eventually, what happens to those flowers? Yeah, they wither. Well, they're already dead. Yeah, right. When they get chopped off, it's done right then. It's just a matter of how long can we make them still look fresh. We can put all that stuff, that little packet of stuff, whatever's in there that you're pouring in and in the water and stick those in there, we're just delaying the inevitable at that moment. Can I tell you that when Jesus Christ redeemed you and the Holy Spirit began to take up residence in you, that that salvation, that that inheritance is absolutely undefiled. It is absolutely unpolluted. It is absolutely perfect and flawless, and it will never fade. Never. Why? Because Jesus rose from the dead, and he's alive. Last thing, that inheritance is kept about and guarded by the power of God. The thought here is that God has put a military garrison like the Romans would surround a city. God is going to has surrounded us with his power, and we are guarded in such a way that our salvation is absolutely secure. I'll ask you one last time. Are you living like Thursday? Are you living like it was never a cross and it was never a resurrection? When people look at your life, do they think about the sacrifice of Christ and the resurrection of Christ? Are you living as though it never happened? I beg you today, if you're not a follower of Christ, don't let this day pass. I urge you to repent of your sin and to follow Christ today. Begin living like it's Sunday. What a great day to do it. Not just Sunday, but Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. And the fact that Jesus lived a perfect life, the fact that he was born to a virgin and lived that perfect life, he died a death that none of us could die. And he rose on that Sunday morning is something that we should never get over. It ought to have an effect on us the same way that we're excited about some football team winning a game or whatever it might be, but it ought to last a whole lot longer than that. I just pray, Lord, that we would begin to be as passionate about Jesus as we are angry that the President of the United States signed that proclamation. I just pray that we would be a people that, while we do have reason to be righteously indignant about things, what we ought to be known for is the love of Christ. Help us live like it's Sunday. And we pray this in Jesus' name. We're going to stand and sing one verse of Jesus Paid It All. What a perfect song. What a perfect song. If you need to come to the altar and pray, you feel free to do that. I told you before, you can come to Christ on a Wednesday, you can come to Christ on a Saturday, or you can come to Christ today. Thank you.
breakfast if you want it over in the life center. Hope you'll come over there and enjoy that. We'll not do anything tonight. Next Saturday is the fish fry. And if you want to volunteer, we've still got to, if you show up and say, I want to help, you know what? You'll help. Somehow. I don't know exactly what, but you'll help. And you can follow all the stuff that's there in the back, in the bulletin on the back page as well. All right? Ms. Robin, anything from you? All right. We'll pray, and that will also be a blessing on the food as well next door. All right? Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We pray that, Lord, we wouldn't live like Thursday. People that don't have a Savior who died and rose on the third day. We pray that, Lord, we would just be people of Christ who would love one another and people that we meet as well. We pray you bless this food to nourish our bodies in Jesus' name.